ಭವಂತಿ ಸರ್ವೇ ಸ ಶಾಂತಿ ಮಾಪ್ನೋತಿ ನ ಕಾಮ ಕಾಮಿ. ಸೊ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಆಪೂರ್ಯಮಾನಂ, ಈಸ್ ಗಿವಿಂಗ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಅ ಓಷನ್. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅನ್ ಓಷನ್, ಮೋರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮೋರ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದಿ ಓಷನ್, ಬಟ್ ದ ಓಷನ್ ನೆವರ್ ಓವರ್ಫ್ಲೋಸ್. ಸಿಮಿಲರ್ಲಿ ಹೀ ಸೇಸ್, ಅ ಸ್ಪಿರಿಚುಲಿ ಅಡ್ವಾನ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್, ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್ ಮೇ ಕಮ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದ ಕಾನ್ಶಿಯಸ್ನೆಸ್, ಬಟ್ ದ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಡಿಸೆಂಟ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟರ್ಬ್, ಡಿಸೆಂಟ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ ಆನ್ ದೋಸ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ದ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಫೋಕಸ್ ಆನ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ವರ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ನ ಕಾಮ ಕಾಮಿ. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಅಲಿಟ್ರೇಷನ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತ, ಇಸ್ ಅ ಪೊಯೆಟ್ರಿ, ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಗೀತ, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೆನಿ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ poetic ornaments are used in the Bhagavad Gita. So many times two words which sound similar and mean similar are brought together to convey a different meaning, like purusham purusharshabha comes in 2.14 in the Bhagavad Gita, 2.15. so like that purusha and purusharshabha, so like that kama and kami, bhutatma bhutatma, many times in the Bhagavad Gita this sort of words are repeated, and that creates a musical effect, a poetic effect, but it also has a semantic effect. Semantic means in terms of conveying meaning. So na kama kami, kama means desire, kami means desirer. So na kama kami means not a desire, a desirer of desire. So na kama kami, normally we think of desirer of sense objects. We said desirer of, somebody's a desirer of sweet, somebody's a desirer of alcohol, somebody may be a desirer of a new smartphone. So, like that, different people may be desirers of different things. So normally, we think of desirer in terms of objects. But here, Krishna is talking about desirer in terms of desires. So, what does desirer of desires mean? This brings in, to answer this, let's consider another point. Normally speaking, desires are something which flow out from us, isn't it? We see something, we feel I want it. Krishna has also talked about that mode, which is dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangasteshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha. This is, we see something, dhyayato, and then sangasteshu, hey, that's nice, and then sangat sanjayate, I want it. So that means from us the desire is going outwards. So this is a normal flow of desires whenever we fall for something which maybe we don't want to do and we end up doing anyway. So although desires normally flow outwards, in this example when Krishna talks about apuryamanamachala pratishtam samudram apah pravishanti advat, and he's comparing desires to rivers. And now rivers flow inwards. Rivers is comparing. So what is the comparison in this particular verse? The ocean is compared to the consciousness of a spiritualist. And the rivers are compared to the desires flowing into the consciousness. So now, what does it mean when desires flow into the consciousness? So that essentially means that it is not so much talking about our desiring something as the proposition for that coming from outside to us. The proposition for that, that means, why don't you do this? Why don't you try that out? That proposition from outside coming to us. So when that comes in, Krishna is saying, that is like the river flowing into the ocean. And so when the kama kami, so although the same word is used, if you want to differentiate between the two, it's a subtle differentiation, and this is a linguistic matter. Different people may differentiate differently. Say, temptation means what comes to us. Desire means what goes out from us. So temptation means something is there out, and then, hey, that's nice. If that object is presenting itself to us and kindling some attraction within us. It's more like calling to us, temptation. And desire is what goes out from us. So, although today's society is highly materialistic and people actually may not think of wanting to give up material desires, people want to enjoy as much as they want, but still, even within such a society also, people do recognize that you cannot give in to every temptation. Nowadays, there is a huge, almost manic obsession with obesity. You shouldn't become too fat. Become too fat. It's almost like a fat person is considered like untouchable today. You know, you're looked down upon and frowned upon, shamed. And it's such a paradox that actually the same culture that glamorizes food in a million ways then condemns obesity in a million ways. So, you know, people get tormented by that. And there are a variety of eating disorders that come up. Now, this bulimia is an eating disorder wherein people are obsessed with their shape. It's largely in females, but sometimes it is in males also. But the idea is that if a person eats some food, so they say, oh, what is this going to? So every time people eat, they get the weight. And they think, how is this going to have my shape? And then sometimes they eat a lot and then they try to vomit it out and they get into a great kind of depression and whole psychological complex comes up. So the point is that it is true that obesity is harmful for health in the long run, but the amount of obsession with it that is there, that is often quite disproportionate with what is required. But even the point I was making here is that even in today's society, people do recognize that, you know, if you eat everything that you can just lay your hands or your tongue on, you're going to grow obese and you have to learn to resist temptation. So in Google, the company Google, not just the Google search engine, they did an experiment. In their canteen, they had their food refreshment store was there. They had these various toffees and sweets, basically. And then, for many years, they had these in transparent containers. And then, many companies are finding that because of people. They call it binge eating. Binge eating means excessive eating. People often get into a lot of health complications. So they, as an experiment, they decided to put all non-essential food items, that means all delicacies which are not really needed for eating, like all sweets, they put them in translucent containers where you couldn't see what they were. Only when you ask, okay, is it there? Then they will tell, okay, it is there, and they'll get out. And they found that just in 6 weeks before this change was made, and 6 weeks after the change was made, the amount of sweet intake among their employees dropped by something like 1 million calories. Phenomenal it was. They have, of course, many employees, and it was not just their employees who would come to the canteen. But the point is that the sales dropped down and the canteen protested against it, but it was an experiment which they did. And their point of the experiment was that perception stimulates temptation. Perception, what we observe, stimulates desire. So, dhyayato vishayan pumsa, what they say, that is what this experiment is about, confirming. So, if you observe something, desire will come out for it. Now, we may say, what is the, isn't it common sense? This is not rocket science. If you're going to see something, you're going to desire it. But, as compared to the extent of a maniac obsession, as I said, people have with either obesity or with weight control, weight loss. Because people spend a lot of money on it. People try to do surgeries and many things they try to do. This was found to be a very simple, relatively simple strategy, which did seem to be able to get people to decrease their food intake. So as they say, out of sight is out of mind. So out of sight is out of mind only if the mind is out of it. That means if the mind is not out of, the mind is already there thinking, I want that. Then even if it's not inside, then we will go and see where I can find it. And I'll get it. So, that means there are two different things we are talking about. One is that there are certain internal impressions within us, which will impel us to go toward the sense objects. And then, there is the external presence of alluring sense objects, which kindles desires within us. In the Uddhava Gita, Krishna tells Uddhava that there is double attraction in this world. The senses are attracted to sense objects and the sense objects are also attracted to the senses. I mean, sense objects, there is this double attraction. So, purification means that the desires inside us go away. We no longer desire that thing. Whereas, self-control means the desire is there, but we don't indulge in it. So, purification will anyway take time. Purification doesn't happen overnight. And we, to go from the state of having unworthy desires to having pure desires, during that phase, we need self-control. So, one way to self-control that they found over here is that just minimize the perception of the sense objects. And that way, we can decrease the indulgence. Some people will anyway, as if they have very strong desires, then they will go anyway, search for it, forget it and enjoy it. But if there is minimal exposure, that helps in decreasing the indulgence. So, started the title of temptations may come, we don't have to welcome. Now, what that means is that when we live in the world, now I talked about temptations in terms of these particular, say, sweets which were there outside. Actually, usually we talk of temptations as something coming from outside. Now this frame of outside and inside is also somewhat mistaken. Because when we think of external as outside and internal as inside, we are still identifying with the body. We are thinking of what is outside the body is external, what is inside the body is internal. But if we understand our identity as souls, then we'll understand that even the mind is external to us. So, what is often thought of as internal is also external to us. Much of what goes on inside us, what is inside me is not me. Or rather, all that is inside me is not me. There is the mind which is inside me and I am not my mind. Now, the idea of the mind, the term mind is used by thinkers all over the world. And different people have different ideas of what the mind actually is. There's one scientist, he said, I will not study the mind only because there's no locus standi. You don't know what is the mind. How can you study a subject which doesn't exist only? So, now, the point is the mind is not a gross object. And that's why we may not study it. But still, the mind is constantly studying us. You know, to find out our weak points and attack us at those weak points. So, we may or may not accept the reality of the mind, but all of us know that there is something inside us which makes us act against our best interests. What that force is, how and when it acts, different people have different ideas. What it may be. But that idea is itself there. So Sigmund Freud is considered to be the father of modern psychology. And he had many different ideas, many of which were quite crazy. One of his ideas, which was not so crazy, was that he said that we all have an intelligence. But that intelligence, he used the word rational faculty or rationality. Our rationality is like a small raft. You know, raft is not a boat, at least has sides. A raft is simply a structure of wood tied together or joined together. So if one wave comes, you'll just fall it off. So our intelligence is like our rationality is like a raft. But below that, there's a turbulent ocean. And that ocean is our irrational emotions. So we all have within us irrational emotions which can at any moment overthrow our intelligence. And his reasoning was that throughout history, when people look back, there are phases of insanity in history. What do phases of insanity mean? That there are times where not just one person, but a whole group of people, hundreds, thousands, act in insane ways. And how anyone could have acted like that, afterwards people wonder, what possessed those people? So for example, when Hitler got power over Germany and converted the whole of Germany to Nazism, then he did the Holocaust. And the way he arranged for the killing of almost 10 million people, 5 million Jews. Yes, there was some animosity between Germans and Jews, but to completely eliminate, or try to eliminate a whole population, millions and millions of people, and to brainwash the whole country like that. How does this thing happen? So, for example, I'm not making a political religious statement over here. I'm just talking about the Holocaust. For us in India, Holocaust seems like a distant reality. But Holocaust is the German killing of the Jews primarily. The Gypsies and some other tribes were also killed, but primarily Jews. So that actually created permanent scars on the human psyche. Till the Second World War, even when the First World War took place, till the Second World War came, there was all over the world a huge amount of optimism that yes, humanity is on the verge of a big breakthrough. And through the power of science and technology, we are becoming the most progressive in the world's history. So science has continued to move on, technology has developed a lot, but all over the world, there is a huge amount of skepticism that has come. And that skepticism has come because, you know, it is a eloquent and tragic statement that, you know, the greatest insight of the greatest mind of the last century caused the greatest disaster of the last century. The greatest mind is considered to be Einstein. His greatest insight was E is equal to mc square. And that led to the development of the atom bomb, which was put on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Now, at one level, the number of deaths in Hiroshima and Nagasaki were much lesser than what were there in Germany. But the whole media narrative at that time was framed in such a way that Germany and the Axis powers were considered to be evil. So evil people doing evil is still bad, but it's to be expected. But the Allies had painted themselves as very good. We are going to the liberators of the persecuted people. Those the Allied Axis powers are so evil. And eventually, Einstein himself went with, Einstein said that the biggest regret of my life was that I sent that letter to President Eisenhower saying that you should develop the atom bomb. He said, my fear was that Germany may develop the atom bomb before us. But actually Hitler was far away from developing an atom bomb. So the point is that when America did that, actually by that time there's a whole bunch of historical analysis. And the point was that Japan was already on the verge of defeat. And Japan would have surrendered anyway. There was no need to have dropped that atom bomb to kill people. And anyway, Hiroshima and Nagasaki were not exactly filled with weapons. They were mostly civilian locations. So that humanity, and not just the portion of humanity that we have painted black, our own people, that means Americans, Europe, the Axis power, Allied powers, humanity can do such brutality that shook the human psyche. And that also led to the further acceptability of Freud's ideas. So he says, what happens? He says, these people have a rational intelligence. But if somehow their irrational emotions are triggered, then they will do irrational things. And there will be phases of insanity in human history. And so what Hitler did, or the dropping of atom bombs, these were not at all, there's no rational reason to do those things. But still people did those things. So now, for example, there is a threat of ISIS. And just a few years ago, maybe a decade ago, that particular area seemed to be like a spent force. After the American invasion of the Gulf and the suppression of powers over there. But now there is a whole resurgence. And what shocks people many times is that many people in this ISIS are tech savvy. You know, ISIS uses social media very effectively in trying to recruit candidates and to promote its own cause. And now some people try to frame this simply in religious terms. No, Islam is bad and is fundamentalist Islam. This is the expression. Now that sort of framing, it misses the essential point that it is not only one religion that has done this, something like this. No, Hitler's Nazi Germany was largely atheistic and it did the same thing. So now roughly correlating Freud's ideas with the Vedic analysis, now what Freud talks about as the rational intelligence, that is like Sattvaguna. And irrational emotions are like Rajoguna and Tamoguna. So Krishna says with Sattvaguna we can understand what should be done, what should not be done. And when Prabhupada went to America, when he was on Jalduta, what did he say? Rajastamo bhave isava. These people are all covered by the modes of passion and ignorance. And that's why we'll see that these people, they do have intelligence. But at the end of the day, when the rub comes, they act irrationally. So it's not so much a matter of this religion being bad or this country being bad, but it's a matter of all over the world, natadasti prithivyam va divideveshu va punah sattvam prakriti jay muktam yadebi syat tribhirgune. Krishna says in 18.40 that what to speak of the earth, even in the heavens, no one is free from the three modes of material nature. So there is goodness, there is passion, ignorance. And there can be religious people who are in ignorance, and these religious people in ignorance will do devastating harm. And again the paradox is, yes, there could have been something like ISIS. There have been many, Genghis Khan did a lot of terrorism, and there are so many other people who did a lot of brutality, vandalism. But technology has made their reach much greater. People can do more brutality, and people can broadcast their brutality over far greater distances. So what applies to brutality, this is a slight detour from the main topic I was taking. I was talking about temptations. So generally when we talk about temptations of lust or greed, but anger is also a temptation. The urge to indulge in violence, that is basically coming from anger. And technology, just as it can facilitate lust, if people want to contaminate their minds, then through the internet people can just browse all the sexually stimulating imagery that is there. People have put it on so many sites. So just as technology can facilitate the aggravation of lust, technology can facilitate the aggravation of anger also. So one young man becomes angry and he takes a machine gun and goes and shoots a dozen people. Or one group of people become disgruntled with mainstream society and they decide to break havoc, and then they can kill thousands of people. So what happens over here is, we live in a culture where, so lust, anger, greed, the six anarthas are there. Let's focus right now on three, because Krishna focuses in the Bhagavad Gita on these three. Trividam narkasilam, dwaram nashanmatmana, kama krodhasaloba tasmadeta trayantajit. So these three are primary, lust, anger, greed. So the current culture is such that with technology, all these three, they can easily be aggravated. Although say in India, possession of guns is still illegal. In America, the possession of guns is considered to be fundamental right. And there is still a debate about, sometimes especially when some trigger happy people go and kill innocent people, then there is a consideration that we should stop having people possessing guns. But still, whether the guns are there or not, so the sheer accessibility of technology makes it possible for anyone. Nowadays, many companies, many employees get very stressed. So in order to anticipate, the incidence of suicide are increasing. So just like some companies say want to ensure that their employees don't surf porn sites during their work hours. So similarly, some companies are also keeping a monitor that are any of our employees searching suicide. Because many people, they get so frustrated and they think, even if I have to die, let me die with a bang, like a flash. So what is the so one of the favorite searches in Google is how to commit a dramatic suicide.
So you know there was this European
air pilot.
So some of you may have heard about the news. So he wanted to do this, he wanted to go out of the bank. So what he was in the plane and he sent the co-pilot out,
and then the plane was just going normally and just sent the plane down. And the co-pilot outside was banging on the door, but he just did not let him in, and he just died. He killed everyone with him. So then there was an editorial. He said, you know, the Twin Towers had prepared us for airplanes being converted into bombs. But who can prepare us for bombs inside the heads of the air pilots?
You know, the desire for
this kind of desire is such a deadly desire. So the point is that technology makes the acting on the lower desires much easier, and the consequences of acting on that much ghastlier. Both ways. It is very easy to act on desires. Now there are even a child, anybody who's a little tech savvy, you know, on the internet, if anybody can search easiest way to murder someone, they say there is a vein at the back of your neck, and if you can somehow catch a person suspecting and press that and shut that, you can kill a person even if you are not stronger than that person. So there is all kinds of, now I'm not blaming technology here, because technology can be used positively, technology can be used negatively. I'm simply making the point that we live in an age where the temptations, not just in terms of lust, but in terms of lust, anger, greed, all temptations, they are fueled much faster. And then in such a culture, what is required is ultimately greater individual responsibility. Greater individual responsibility. That means, just like with respect to advertisements, if people want to avoid obesity, what do they have to do ultimately? They have to take responsibility for how much they eat. So there may be advertisements all around, but people have to control themselves. So becoming responsible in this way is not at all easy. Is extremely difficult. So with respect to the availability of temptations, that is something which is unlikely to change in the near future. A society, the way it is going, unless there are some cataclysmic changes, the way the culture is going right now, the access, the availability of avenues for indulging in lust, indulging in greed, indulging in anger, they are going to be there. And they're going to be there more and more. See, frustration has always been there throughout human society, throughout human history. Now, life is such that life will cause frustration. Now, whether it is the BC or the AD, whether it's the modern age, the pre-modern age, the post-modern age, wherever it is, the nature of this world is our plans will go wrong, we'll get frustrated, people will disappoint us, people will betray us. And how do we deal with problems? That is the essential human art of living. The essential human art of living is how we deal with problems. Because problems are just a fact of life. So now, temptations, usually people don't think of them as problems. People think of temptations as something which we enjoy, but if you enjoy too much, then it will become a problem. That is the idea. But two problems come up. The whole idea of enjoyment, the way it is glamorized in today's culture, that little is never enough. It becomes like that. Now, people say you enjoy in regulation. But the problem with enjoying in regulation is, regulation does not provide satisfaction. because the mind craves more and more and more. And especially in a culture where the most alluring sense objects are brought in front of people from everywhere. I had gone for a college program. So people sometimes write provocative things on their t-shirts just to catch attention. So this boy had written on his t-shirt that 90% of the world's women are beautiful and the remaining 10% are in my college.
So what it means is that
actually speaking, the whole, how do people get the idea of 90%? Now that is based on what they see in the movies, what they see in the advertisements, what they see in the media, which don't even show the most attractive women. They show the most attractive women in the most with the most makeup. And then, as compared to that, you know, when the senses get habituated to that kind of sensory fare, the sensory fare means that kind of sensual titillation, then what real life offers is always going to be pale in comparison. So, that's why even from the material point of view, leave alone spiritual point of view, even from the material point of view, the people can never get enough material enjoyment. At one level, you know, we can say lust is itself insatiable. That is true at one level, but at another level, there is... There have been, whether it is in traditional Indian culture or the culture, traditional culture in other parts of the world, there have always been people who have been living wild, but a large majority of population has always lived more or less regulated lives. So for example, married life. Now, there may be people who may have relationships outside marriage, but largely people lived in a civilized way with married life. But in today's culture, with so much sensual titillation brought from everywhere, people just are never satisfied with what they have. And that's why, as Krishna says, that aneka chitta vibhranta moha jala samavrutaha prasaktaha kama bhogeshu patanti narakeshu chau. Aneka chitta vibhranta, chitta, the consciousness is pulled in different directions. Moha jala samavrutaha, completely covered with illusion. Prasaktaha kama bhogeshu, in the desire, one is strongly attached, prasaktaha. And then these desires don't only drag a person down, they drag a person down to hellish conditions. Patanti narakeshu chau, down to hell. So, as I said, all that I described right now was about temptations may come. So temptations, it's not a may, they are going to come. And they're going to come more and more. May means I'm talking in terms of how much we expose ourselves to them. So, but we don't have to welcome. That I'll talk about the second part now. So, for all of us, changing the external world to minimize temptations is not much in our control. But still, we can all find what we can do. Just like I started with the example of the Google experiment. Just put the food items in translucent containers. The temptation decreases. So each of us can find out what are our temptations and whether we can minimize their prevalence or our encounter of them in our day-to-day course. We cannot change the way people dress. We cannot change the way what is going to come on television, what has come on the hoardings. But we can, in our own situation, check how we can minimize that. So, it can vary from very simple things to small things, you know. No, we all have device, and for many people, device becomes the gateway to vice. Device becomes the gateway to vice. That means whatever devices are there, from there people can just go anywhere and everywhere, and they can contaminate their minds. So how can we minimize our exposure to temptation? Yes, even if we have devices, we don't have to have unregulated net access on the devices. We can have some net filter. We can have some way of controlling what we are exposing ourselves to. So like that, you know, we may have craving for food, but it's not that we have to starve, But we can make sure the food that we have around us is healthy food. It's prasad and it's healthy prasad, whatever is available. So if you feel hungry, so these are all various practical measures which each of us can take so that we do not expose ourselves to unnecessary temptation. Certain amount of exposure to temptation is unavoidable. But we often expose ourselves more than what is necessary. That we can avoid. But more important is the internal response. So there are, you know, when in the Ramayana, Sugriva faces temptation twice. First is that he is exiled and he's living in the forest. Now he's living in austerity as an exilee, and then Ram reinstates him as a king. And then there are the 4 months of the rainy season. At that time, nobody can move around. So Ram says, I'll stay in the forest. Actually, Sugriva invites Ram. He's come and stay with me in the kingdom. He says, no, my father has said that I have been sentenced to exile. That means not just outside my kingdom, outside any kingdom. So I cannot stay in your kingdom. I'll stay on the outside. Now, during those 4 months, Sugriva succumbs completely, gives into his senses. And now Sugriva is not a demon, nor is he a non-devotee. But after living deprived of any kind of sense gratification while in the forest, when he suddenly is placed in royal opulence and with profuse availability of sense gratification, he succumbs to it. And he succumbs to it to such an extent that he forgets his duty. And then when Lakshmana comes there, at that time Hanuman also before him warns him, Tara warns him, and then he comes to his senses. So here we see that Sugriva is more a victim of his circumstance than a evil person. A victim of circumstance means that a person is put in a tempting situation and then that person goes into temptation. The other is a person intentionally goes into a tempting situation and falls for sense gratification. Later, when the war of at Lanka is about to take place, so Ravana initially is very dismissive. Who is this? Who is this human? But after he sees the prowess of Ram, after he hears about, after he calmly contemplates how Hanuman has devastated half of my city, how Ram alone killed all the 40,000 warriors at Janasthan, he becomes a little sober. And then he thinks that, let me try divide and rule. So he tries to tempt twice. First, he tries to tempt Angad. And he tells him, your father was the king. And the two people who were the murderers of your father, why are you serving them? You come on my side and I will make you the next king, as your father would have wanted him to be. So Angad says, oh, so you know my father's will better than my father? He says, my father told me before Wali dies, Wali says, you know, serve Sugriva and serve Ram. So he says, so Ravana had not expected this reply. He just becomes silenced. And then similarly, he tries to tempt Sugriva. And he says to Sugriva, he says, we have no enmity against each other. When Wali was the king, you know, we had an agreement and we were both living peacefully. He says, why are you creating hostility between two friends for something which is not your business at all? So, and he says, you live with your troops and I will give you profuse wealth. So, now Angada has gone as a messenger to Ravana's palace. At that time, Ravana tells him personally. But when Sugriva, Ravana doesn't tell personally, he sends messengers. So when he sends his messengers, Sugriva at that time utterly refuses. Not only refuses, he catches those messengers and he drags them to Ram. And he says, you know, these are, so how they come in? They have impersonated as monkeys. The demons, they can change their form. So they change their form, they become monkeys and they come in. So when they come in over there, at that time, he catches them. He says, these are spies. So when Ram hears what has happened, he says, you know, they had come as messengers, send them back. And he says, before you send them back, you give them a tour of our whole army encampment. So he says, shocked, you know, that's what they wanted to know. They had been sent for first to tempt Sugriva and other to do reconnaissance to see what is their strength. So Ram says, no, that will be, you know, no army tells the other army what all your, how you have arranged your forces, how many, this is all secret information. So there's element of surprise. So Ram says, no, if he sees how many forces we have, maybe this Ravana will come to his senses. And he will desist from the war. So the point is that Sugriva at that time utterly rejects the temptation. Doesn't even consider it. So what is the difference in the first situation and the second situation? Now, the main difference is his purposefulness. When he is in Lanka, he has brought his army, they are camped around the fort of Lanka, around Ravana's fort in Lanka. At that time, they have come with a full sense of purpose that we are going to defeat Ravana. We are going to get reclaim Sita. Whereas when he was living in Kishkinda, he had no purpose. He was just, okay, I've got the thing, let me enjoy royal luxury. So, we as living beings, who we are innately pleasure seeking. What we can do is delay pleasure. We can't deny pleasure. We can't deny ourselves of pleasure. But delay means that if we are convinced of some cause which requires some austerity, some suffering, some renunciation, some sacrifice now, but which will give higher return later, then we can delay pleasure. But if we are told deny pleasure, then it is not, we can't do that. Now, if we have a sense of spiritual purpose, if I am a sadhaka, I am practicing sadhana bhakti, and by this practice of sadhana bhakti, I will move closer and closer to Krishna. By the practice of bhakti, I will be sharing spiritual knowledge with others. I will be benefiting others. Then that sense of purposefulness, although initially we may not experience much higher pleasure, but just the sense of purposefulness enables us to delay pleasure. But when there is no purposefulness like that, then if the temptation comes, then it just seems like denial. Oh, there is pleasure, why should I say no to it? So if we focus on saying no to temptation, we will not succeed. You know, the process of bhakti is not emptying the mind of temptation. The process of bhakti is crowding temptation out of the mind. Now, for example, this room is there. And if we decide to make a full vacuum in this room, you know, what kind of vacuum machine will require, and then small window or small door open somewhere, again air will come in. But if this room is filled with, say, water, then air will automatically go out. So like that, if our focus, as I said, temptation, we don't have to welcome temptation. That's the point we're discussing. So if our focus is on saying no to temptations, then that is denial. And denial is never sustainable. But if our focus is on serving Krishna, if our focus is on moving closer to Krishna, then we can delay temptation, we can delay pleasure. Understanding that, yatta dagre vishamiva pariname amrutopamam. Yes, there may be some poison initially, but there is nectar eventually. And therefore, we can delay. Now sometimes you may say that even delaying pleasure requires determination. And I don't have determination. Actually, it is completely wrong to say that I don't have determination. What we lack is not determination. What we lack is direction for our determination. What do you mean by direction for our determination? Actually, we may say, oh, to give up sense gratification requires determination. Yes, giving up sense gratification requires determination, but holding on to sense gratification also requires determination.
Isn't it?
We often, when we indulge in our senses, we face the consequences. And in spite of facing the consequences, still we hold on to it. Yaya swapnam bhayam shokam vishadam madamevacha na vimunchati durmedha dhruti sa partha tamasi. Krishna talks about determination in the mode of ignorance. And he says, gives characteristics. Yaya swapnam bhayam shokam. Simple Sanskrit. You know, people daydreaming, grieving. Now, some people are habitually morose. You know, whatever you show them, they will tell you all the problems in that. They're just habitual negative thinkers. And such people, you know, this moroseness, it doesn't do any good to anyone, even to them. You know, if you are habitually morose, then how can you be enthusiastic about doing anything? Now, this moroseness is sapping their energy and still they continue to be morose. That requires determination. Isn't it? Na vimunchati durmedha. So, durmedha, misdirected intelligence. Na vimunchati, don't give it up, although it does no good to them. So, to hold on to an attachment also requires determination. We don't just require determination to give up attachment. To hold on to attachment also requires determination. And often, we may not feel that as determination because we define determination in a particular way. But doing anything while enduring something unfavorable for the sake of doing it, that is determination. So, when people overeat or people say drink, you know, after drinking they have a hangover. And yet next time they drink. That is determination. Isn't it? But, of course, this kind of determination has an appropriate word for it. And that is? Addiction. Yeah. But the negative is obstinacy. Or stubbornness. So, that is, point is, it's not that we lack determination. No one lacks determination. All of us have determination. So, what we lack is the direction for our determination. And if you understand this point that all of us already have determination, we just need to redirect it. And then, we focus on the practice of bhakti. So, I'll conclude with one point, then we can have some question answers. So, when we are trying to say, is that we don't have to welcome temptations. So, the best way to deal with temptations is to not deal with them. That means, if some temptation comes, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, later, now. So once we start dealing with them, just like, you know, sometimes a salesman comes and then the salesman is trying to sell us something. Now, if you try to persuade the salesman, no, I don't want this. The salesmen are often, they are master arguers. Oh, as they say, you know, a good advertiser is one who can sell a refrigerator to an Eskimo. So like that, advertisers are expert. And they can... So, marketers, advertisers, sales agents, they're experts. So, if you try to deal with them, no, I don't need this. They will persuade you that not only you need it, you may need it. You need it now. So, like that, if this temptation is there. Should I indulge? Should I not indulge? Should I indulge? Should I not indulge? You know, if we start dealing with temptation, it's very unlikely that we will be devoured by temptation. So the best way to deal with temptation is to not deal with temptation. That means what? As Prabhupada was asked that once one devotee in Vrindavan asked Prabhupada, you know, our purpose is to serve Krishna, then why is Maya so strong? So Prabhupada said, because your purpose is not strong. Because your purpose is not strong. That means if we focus on positive activity, on keeping ourselves busy in Krishna's service, we don't leave much temptation. So we don't welcome means it's not it. Okay. We are waiting for temptation to come. And when temptation comes, no, you're not welcome over here. It's not that we do like that. We just are so busy that we don't notice temptation. Now you may say, how is that possible? There's so much all around us. The world is filled with temptations. Yes, that is true. The world is filled with temptations. But all of us do have determination to some extent. You know, if we are studying for our exams, at that time also, you can go on the internet and we can surf 100 things. We can watch cricket matches. We can do so many things. But we do study at that time. We all have certain level of determination. And all that is primarily required is increasing our purposefulness. So, for us, what will make us purposeful? There is no stereotype in that. Now we say ultimately our purposefulness is that we have to serve Krishna, we have to love Krishna, we have to attain Krishna. That is true. But what will inspire us right now in our bhakti, that is something each of us has to find out. So some of us may be inspired by chanting, some of us may be inspired by studying scripture, some of us may be inspired more by memorizing verses, some of us may like kirtans. And this is, I am talking about directly devotional activities. See, directly devotional activities are important for us to get contact with Krishna, to absorb our mind with spiritual potency. But along with that, even in our work, even in our other worldly activities, we need to find out how we can stay purposeful. That means when we say we have to know ourselves. Know ourselves at one level means to know the soul. But know ourselves also means to know our psychophysical nature. So that means if I am studying and say I start studying, some students may be able to study for 3-4 hours without any disturbance. Just continue studying. Others may study for 30 minutes and need a break after that. Now if I start comparing myself with somebody who's, if I can study for 30 minutes and I start comparing myself with somebody who can study for 3 hours, I'll unnecessarily put myself in inferiority complex. You study for 30 minutes, take a 5-minute break, again start studying. Impossible. Somebody else may study for 3 hours and that person may take a 30-minute break after that. Whatever. Different people are different. So, one problem in today's world is that certain models, certain things become glamorized. And once, for example, certain careers become glamorized. So, say engineering or medicine or whatever. Then everybody wants to go in that direction. So, like that, even in our life, we may find that certain patterns of behavior may get glamorized. I'm not saying the patterns of behavior are wrong, but it's the shoe that fits one person bites another person. Is it? Different people have legs of different size. So similarly, materially, all of us are different. And if we try to, instead of understanding our own nature, if we just try to imitate others, then we will set ourselves for frustration. And what happens is, when we try to do something that we are not materially capable of doing, then the frustration that comes from that, that affects our spiritual life. Because of the material frustration, we become discouraged in our spiritual life. Because we become discouraged in our spiritual life, we fall prey to temptation. And because we fall prey to temptation, we become further frustrated. So in that way, a devotee can unnecessarily get into depression. So when we as devotees are practicing spiritual life, is not just about how we do our sadhana. It is also about how we live our material life. And that means, now we may not have so much freedom, you know, we are in a particular career right now, or a particular course, particular educational pattern. We may not have complete freedom to change our course track, and that may not be necessary also. But we observe ourselves and learn what is the way I work best. And when we learn that, and then rather than comparing and competing with others, we compare and compete with ourselves. That means, okay, this, if I do like this, I was able to do this much. And if I continue on this, now I'll be able to do this much more. Then we will be on the path of self-improvement. If we keep comparing with others, we will put ourselves on the path of self-disempowerment. Unnecessarily discourage and dishearten ourselves. But if we compare with ourselves, understand ourselves, understand our own nature. And again, Krishna talks about the nature quite a few times in the Bhagavad Gita. So there is one verse, he says, Sadrushim Cheshtute Sasya Prakriter Jnanavanapi Prakritim Yanti Bhutani Nigraha Kim Karishyati. Krishna says that all living beings act according to nature, and even the wise people act according to nature. So what can repression accomplish? So there is one organization, according to them, the essence of Bhagavad Gita is, what can repression accomplish? Nigraha Kim Karishyati. And they teach. So therefore, Sambhoksa Samadhi. Just enjoy, and then eventually you'll give up enjoyment. You'll transit. Actually, now people never give up enjoyment. So, but what when Krishna is saying Nigraha Kim Karishyati, if you see that verse, just before that verse and after that verse, Krishna is talking about sense control. So this is 3.34, and just before that, after that, there is a whole section from 3.36 onwards where Krishna talks about Atake, what is it that makes one do sinful activity? It is karma. And Krishna says, you have to control karma. And just before that, Krishna says, Indriyasya indriyasya arthe raga dvesha vyavasitau tayor navashama agacche tau yasya paribandhinau. That the sense sense objects are obstacles on our spiritual path, we need to control ourselves. So what Krishna is talking about here, nigraha kim karishyati, he's not talking about our desires in terms of lust, anger, greed. He's talking about our nature. So all of us, we have a particular nature. Now, in the broad Bhagavata's context, in the Bhagavata specific context, it can refer to Varnashram and Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. In general, also beyond that specific Varnashram categorization, it also refers to the individual kind of machine that we have. You know, like many of us may be using computers. And although all computers have some similar functions, all computers are meant to serve similar purposes, but each computer may be of a different make and it may have its own idiosyncrasies. Now you do this for this function, you do this for this function, you do this for this function. And a good computer user understands what kind of machine I have and then optimizes the use of that. So now if I try to use a Windows machine like a Mac machine, it will not work. That Krishna is saying Nigraha Kim Karishyati. That means if I have a particular kind of body-mind machine, I cannot make it work in another way. But that does not mean that I have to indulge in every urge of the body-mind machine. It simply means that there are certain desires which come, which are irrational, which we want to control. But apart from that, there is a nature which we understand and we harmonize with. And then we can, actually speaking, when we live this way, we'll be able to be both spiritually and materially effective. Spiritually, we'll be able to connect with Krishna nicely in our sadhana bhakti. And materially, whatever time we are investing in our worldly activities, we'll be productive in that. We'll be able to work efficiently. So I'll summarize. I started by talking about how Krishna says that nakama kami, do not be a desirer of desire. That means there are temptations which are going from come from the external world. We do not have to accept those temptations. So by temptations coming from the external world, I talked about at that time, about how lust, anger, greed, the avenues for indulging in them, they have increased tremendously in today's world. And I talked about Freud's analysis of how there is our rational intelligence is like a canoe, and below that there's a turbulent ocean of irrational emotions. That's like Sattvaguna is very small, and below that is a huge force of Rajaguna and Tamaguna. And when that somehow through brainwashing, through indoctrination, through glamorization, if that irrational emotion is triggered, then people act irrationally. And even against their own intelligence. So as I talked about in history, phases of insanity are there. And then, so in today's culture, it is difficult to avoid the prevalence of temptations in the outer world. But still within that, we can regulate to some extent. I give the example of the Google experiment. Is converting transparent to translucent sweet items that decrease the food intake. So like that, we can find out how within the course of our life, we can minimize our exposure to temptations. But beyond that, when temptations are unavoidable, what do we do is, we don't focus on saying no to them. Rather, we focus on saying yes to Krishna. We can't deny our need for pleasure. But we can delay that for a higher purpose. And that delaying will be possible to the extent we are convinced about the higher purpose. So, by practicing sadhana bhakti, by studying scriptures, by using our intelligence, we get the conviction for the higher purpose. And that conviction, see, conviction is in terms of our acceptance. And determination is in terms of our action, our execution. So I said that what we lack is not determination, but direction for our determination. And we just redirect our determination towards Krishna. And towards the end, we concluded by discussing about how the process of bhakti centers on not just practicing direct devotional activities, that's important, but along with that, understanding the kind of machine that we have, the kind of body-mind mechanism we have, and then using it most effectively. And one of the greatest obstacles to using the body-mind machine that we have effectively is comparing unnecessarily with others. So rather than comparing with others, we understand ourselves and compare with ourselves. That way we can be on the path of self-improvement. And then we can become both materially and spiritually effective. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Praji, the last point which you told that we should not compare with others, rather we should utilize our machine more effectively. Means we should understand it and then accordingly we should work. So can you just please elaborate a little more? Because when we are in a particular setup, so already we are doing the things in a certain way. And moreover, when we try to go about understanding, so it may happen that some whimsical things which might be there, we end up doing that, like acting on that kind of desires rather than acting in self-interest.
The question is that when we work in a particular setup and then within that if we try to understand our nature and act according to nature, that may disturb the setup and also we might end up acting whimsically. Yeah. In general, unless there is a good level of sattva-guna, we can't even observe ourselves. So otherwise rajaguna and tamaguna is so much, if I'm looking at an object but my glasses are very very dusty, I can't even see it properly. So in the initial stages of our bhakti, it is good to just do what we are told. By that rajaguna tamaguna will subside. Prabhupada writes in the introduction of Nectar of Instruction that by practicing the principles we'll come to the mode of goodness, and thereafter how to advance will be revealed from within. After we come to goodness, how to advance further will be revealed from within. That means that initially, if we just start saying, this is what I want to do, this is what my nature is, it's quite likely that it's not our nature, it is just the mind's trick to look for a shortcut. So initially, we just follow the process. But while following the process also, we observe ourselves. And what are the things while doing which I feel satisfied, I feel enlivened, what are things that I am good at? And in that way, it's like in a military, initially there is standardized discipline for everyone. But eventually, different people in the army become specialists in different things. And that is dependent not just on the initial training is like a mandated instruction for everyone. But different people will become specialists depending on their talents, their abilities, their physical endowments. And so like that, when we say know ourselves, it's not just we alone doing that. We do that and our spiritual guides are also observing us. And it's a cooperative process. And if you are part of a particular setup, then it's best to not disturb that. But that does not mean that we should not be observing and learning about ourselves. And generally a difference between a whimsical urge and an insight into our own nature is that the urge is just fleeting. The urge comes and it goes. Usually when it's a whimsical urge, it's largely a matter of the grass is greener on the other side. You know, I'm doing this service, this is so difficult. Hey, this is not my nature only. That service is my nature. And then I do that service, so this service is also not my nature. So basically, the service which I am doing is not my nature. That's what it boils down to. So we should do like that. What we focus on is, we try to do the services that we are told, but along with that we observe. And over a period of time, we will ourselves understand. And we can always consult with our senior devotees. And then by that we can develop whatever talents we have. So my focus is not on independent decision making in terms of being whimsical, but in terms of taking responsibility for understanding ourselves. See, ultimately, our spiritual advancement is our responsibility. No, our spiritual master is not going to remember Krishna for us at the time of our death, nor even in our life also. So it is our responsibility. And the spiritual master is there to guide us, to inspire us. Prabhupada says each of us has to fly our own plane. That just doesn't mean that, you know, we have to individually reject temptation. That is true. It also means we have to individually find out how we can best serve Krishna. So it's a process of consultation, guidance and growth. But sometimes in the focus on following instruction, the role of individual responsibility is lost. Yes, I should follow what I'm told to do, but along with that, I should also be using my intelligence to observe myself, to learn. Then that will lead to more sustained growth. Okay? Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Guruji. Guruji, in the class, we discussed about welcoming temptation. We are putting a curtain on welcoming temptation. How should we look if we are already indulged in something? I mean, we are at a stage and we have already given up to the temptation. That is, I mean, like one question which I wanted to ask you. How to come out of that stage? And in that that moroseness, you were mentioning that thing, that moroseness aspect.
So, if we have already indulged in some temptation and are caught in it and we have become morose because of that, how do we deal with that? So, in general, moroseness comes not because of our indulgence in the temptation. It is because of our self-centered focus. Self-centered focus means that we are still after that, oh, I did this, I did that, why did I do it? I should not have done that. I am such a fool. I. It's ultimately I-centered. And the whole process of bhakti is to stop being I-centered and to become Krishna-centered. So, no matter what wrong we have done, Krishna never leaves our heart and goes away. Krishna always stays in our heart. And the opportunity for practicing bhakti still stays with us. So we focus, yes, even if we have indulged, no matter how badly we indulge, our focus should always be on practicing bhakti. So if we focus on all the wrongs that we have done, that will definitely make us morose and it will become very difficult for us to have any enthusiasm. Okay, now there is one negative attitude is to think, chalta hai. That is, you know, oh, whatever wrong I do, I'm just chanting Hare Krishna, everything is all right. No, we are not talking about that. Yes, if there is something wrong with us, we should take it seriously. Yes, it's wrong and I want to take steps to avoid it and I will do whatever steps it takes. But the focus eventually should be on Krishna. The focus should not be on, okay, so many bad things I have done. Even if we have done bad things, then also we can turn. If your mind goes, you know, you are such a fool, such a sinner, you are this, you are that. Okay. Even if it is all true, still Krishna is so kind that he is allowing me to practice bhakti. So, how merciful Krishna is. Let me focus on Krishna. So, if we focus on Krishna, moroseness will go away. If we focus on ourselves, we will have either of the two. We will feel very bad about ourselves or we'll feel very good about ourselves. And both are bad. You know, feeling very good about ourselves also is bad. So in general, our lapses, our slips, our falls, you know, it's not that 24 hours a day we are fallen down only. No, yes, sometimes temptations come and we fall. So what defines us, what defines our bhakti is not so much how we fall, but what we do between the falls. What we do between the falls. Yeah, sometimes temptations come and I may fall. But what am I doing in between? If in between I am trying to practice bhakti intensely, if I am trying to pray to Krishna, if I am trying to strengthen myself, then gradually, so it's like, you know, if you have a waveform, there are spikes which come. So material desires, they spike up sometimes. But, so sometimes in the initial stages, combating and resisting those spikes may be difficult. But what do we do in between the spikes? That is important. If at that time we are strengthening ourselves by practicing bhakti, eventually we will be able to resist the spikes also. But if after the spike has come and gone also, then also you are, why did the spike come? When is the spike going to come next? Then we are just thinking about that. then we are not strengthening ourselves, we are weakening ourselves. That's why, you know, we should know that Krishna's love for us is not based on who we are. Krishna's love for us is based on who He is. It is His selfless, compassionate nature because of which He loves us. So no matter how fallen we are, Krishna is not going to stop loving us. And that's why as devotees, we shouldn't focus so much on ourselves. So if we focus on Krishna and try to connect ourselves with Krishna, then we can avoid morosness. And the spikes, we have to plan how I can deal with those spikes. So the spikes which they come, the spikes, the strong desires that come, how to deal with those spikes, we can plan in that in such a way that, see, there are two things which we can do. One is pushers towards Krishna, and the other is blockers between Maya, blockers in the direction of Maya. That means if we indulge in a particular temptation, we try to create obstacles between us and that temptation. Now, ultimately, we can just break down the obstacle and go and fall in the temptation. That can happen. But if there is a blocker, it slows down the process. And usually, you know, when the desires come, they for some time, they just madden us. But if there is a little delay in that also, like when Bilwa Mangal Thakur went to enjoy with Chintamani, you know, he was intoxicated. But at that time when Chintamani spoke, tak, his intelligence awakened. So like that, if we can create some blockers between, like basically, you know, covering that sweet item in a translucent box, that's like creating a blocker. So to deal with the spikes, we can find out what blockers we can create. And then if we also have pushers towards Krishna, what are the ways in which we can take shelter of Krishna easily? What are the ways in which we can pray to Krishna? See, bhakti is not just a matter of ritual. That means it's not just chant Hare Krishna, everything will be all right. Yes, that is true, but chanting Hare Krishna is not just a verbal activity. It's activity of the heart. So sometimes we may find that we can take shelter of Krishna in some other way. You know, having other way means not that we are replacing chanting Hare Krishna, but that we may be able to, in the times of temptation, connect with Krishna in some other way better. You know, if we have some very sweet kirtans which we love, just hearing those kirtans, you know, we say, hey, there is so much higher taste available, why am I going this direction? Or if we have some deity darshan which really catches our, attracts us. It's just to keep that with us and look at that. And then after that, we can take shelter of the holy name, we can take shelter of Krishna. So, we have to find out what are our pushers towards Krishna. And we surround ourselves with them more and more. And whatever are our blockers between us and Maya, we create more blockers. And that way we can avoid both the moroseness and the relapse into whatever we may have indulged in. And we can come out of that. Okay? Thank you. Yeah, any other questions?
Prabhuji, we may not compare with others, but if others are comparing with us, means like they may be in a better situation or something like that.
Okay,
so,
I understood the question. Yeah.
So they are not understanding our situation. So what we are doing, we may have blessings of superior or something like that. So how to deal with that? So we don't want to prove or something like that, or we are just trying to improve something like that. So in that situation.
Yeah. So the question is that we may not want to compare with others, but others may be comparing us with others, and then that may create some problems for us. So how do we deal with that?
Yeah, when I said we should not compare with others, that does not deny the reality that we live in a comparative world. In the sense that if we are in an exam, if we are in an educational system, people are going to compare. Oh, you got this much marks, that person got that much marks, that much person got this much. So in the material world, there is so much comparison which is unavoidable. Even in bhakti, there is some amount of, you know, if we are doing some service, okay, you are doing some preaching, how many people came from your program, for your meditation circle, or how many books you distributed, or what is your sadhana score. And there can be comparisons like that. So now the point is, we can't do away with comparison entirely. And in Rajoguna, when we are in Rajoguna, to some extent comparison can help also. Because there are two different things over here. there is lack of performance because of lethargy, and there is lack of performance because of incompatibility or inability. That means if there is something which we can do, but it's just like if you go to a library to study and there are five people and five of them are sleeping, that you will also feel like sleeping over there, isn't it? Now, that is simply others' lethargy coming to us. So we are social creatures and we are affected by the social circle around us. There's no denying that. So often, at some level, when we are in Rajoguna, comparison pulls us out of our lethargy. There are things which we can do, but which we won't do if we don't see others also being lazy. But if we see others exerting, then we also exert. So we can't and we needn't do away entirely with comparison. What I'm talking about when I say is that we shouldn't compare with others is, we don't give excessive importance to comparison. Or rather that we don't make how we stand in a comparative setting the sole definer of our self-worth. If I am not number one, then I am useless. No, it doesn't have to be like that. So, Prabhupada also encouraged book distribution. And he would tell different temples, the more temple books you will distribute, I'll come there. So, comparison is not wrong. But then, Prabhupada also wanted devotees to do other things also. You build temples, you make devotees. So, there are various other definitions of success also in bhakti. So, it's not necessary to give up comparison entirely. And if others are comparing, we can see whether that comparison can strike off some of the lethargy within us. But beyond that, if others are comparing too much, then we may have to find at least some friends who understand us. See, one of the biggest discouragers in our life is mixing with people whose definition of success is different from ours. This happens clearly between materialists and spiritualists. The materialists think, how much money I earn, how much this I do, how much that's a success for me. Now, devotees don't have that definition of success necessarily. But even in devotional life, if we are doing a particular service and then somebody else is caught in some other service, we respect that service. But then that service definition of success is different. This service definition of success may be different. So if we have a particular interest, a particular ability, particular focus, then it's good to associate with people who also, others who have that focus, and they will understand our situation. They'll understand our situation and then we can move forward. So, to find like-minded devotees, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Sajati Ashastinda Sangha, that's important. So, that problem of others comparing us with others will happen largely if we do not have like-minded association. And we will never have fully like-minded association. But even if we find a few devotees who are like-minded, that can make our practice of bhakti much smoother. And we should take the responsibility to find that kind of association. See, association doesn't mean, we need to have basic working relationship with the devotees with whom we are living. But ultimately, the inspiring association may well be available somewhere else. So we have to also look for that association. That doesn't mean we are minimizing the association that is around us. Simply understand that we are individuals. And as individuals, we have to find out how our individuality can be best used in Krishna's service. Okay? Thank you.
Yes. Guruji, when we are trying to serve devotees in engaging them, so we are finding that as time is going, the modern lifestyle is making them even go out during morning program and not be available for services later. So, first of all, we don't understand their nature, we cannot understand, and when we are trying to engage them, they are not available to execute those activities. And they're spending more time in getting the temptations because they're spending out. So, how we can serve them properly?
Okay, the question is, the modern lifestyle is such that people are caught on a lot of temptations and they don't understand their nature, we don't understand their nature, and even if you want to give them basic treatment by which they can become purified, come to Sattva Guna, then they are not ready to even take their basic training, come for the morning program. So then how do we engage them? See, one of the first principles of medical treatment is you cannot treat a patient unless that patient is willing to take the treatment. In epidemics and other emergency situations, sometimes the medicines are given, but you cannot force people. So Srila Prabhupada was asked at one time, how much can we push people? So he said, an example, that suppose somebody is in a vehicle and the vehicle is not moving. Sometimes in India it happens. Then the vehicle doesn't move, and 4 or 5 people come and push the vehicle from outside. And then the person also inside is started. And then it moves forward. And then it moves on. But imagine if 4 or 5 people are pushing from outside and inside this driver has gone to sleep. Or worse still, the driver is putting the brake. Then these 4 or 5 people, why should they push along? So similarly, there are some people who are not at all interested in spiritual advancement. Then trying to push them, engage them, it's not going to work. Better focus our energy on those who are interested. But there are people who may borderline cases, who do not necessarily fit into a particular program for engaging them in bhakti or for helping them grow in bhakti. Then we have to, based on whatever set structure we are in, whatever setup we are in, if we can give them some services which keep them engaged. See, Krishna is quite accommodating from 12.8 onwards to 12.11. He says, fix your mind on me. If you can't fix your mind, practice sadhana bhakti. If you can't practice sadhana bhakti, work for me. If you can't work for me, then you give the fruits of your work for me. He gives multiple levels. So like that, we can also try to fit people in some level. So it's not necessarily 1-0 entirely. Ultimately, there are multiple levels at which bhakti can be practiced. And yes, if people are not ready to come for the morning program, and they are, that doesn't necessarily mean that they have no interest in bhakti. They may have some interest in doing some service for Krishna, and then we need not spend too much time trying to engage them. If they have some interest, if there's something which they like to do, they can do. And Krishna follows the principle of yathamam prapadyante. As all people surrender, I reciprocate accordingly. So we can follow. If people are interested in doing something, if we can accommodate them, we accommodate them. Otherwise, we are available for them when they want to become more serious in bhakti. There is no need to impose on people standards that they are not ready to follow. A little bit pushing is okay. But trying to impose on them standards which they are not ready to follow will alienate them. And if they become alienated, then even if later they realize the value of bhakti, that alienation will become a block in their coming to Krishna. But if we have cordial relationship with them, Krishna also says, manushyanam sahasreshu kashchit siddhaye. So out of thousands, one endeavors, and me, and out of that, one attains me. So we can see that, maybe 50 to 100 people may come for a DYS camp, but then when people are joining voice, there may be 5 or 10 boys who join voice. So now the others, it's not that, all of you, you disappointed me, you betrayed me, I spent so much time on you. It's not like that. They are not ready right now, fine. But they had some appreciation, that's why they came for the DYS program, they came for the first camp or whatever. So if you just have cordial relationship with them, we recognize that they are not at that level of serious or a taitra, but they also have some interest, and who knows, that interest will grow later. So we don't have to spend time on people who are not really serious or not interested in becoming serious. But just because they are not ready to become serious, that doesn't mean we have to alienate them. So if we can accommodate them well and good, otherwise just have a cordial relationship and leave it up to Krishna and with them when they want to take a bhakti more seriously. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. So today we will be discussing on the topic of temptations may come, we don't have to welcome. So this will be based on 2.70 in the Bhagavad Gita. 2.70 is apuryamanam achala pratishtham samudramapah pravishanti yadvad tadvat kamayam pravishanti sarve sa shantim apnoti na kama kami. So Krishna here speaks that apuryamanam, He is giving the example of an ocean. And this is an ocean, more and more water comes into the ocean, but the ocean never overflows. Similarly, he says, a spiritually advanced person, the desires may come into the consciousness, but the person doesn't get disturbed, doesn't act on those desires. So the words which I will focus on in this verse is na kama kami. So this is a alliteration in the Bhagavad Gita is a poetry, it's a Gita. And many different poetic ornaments are used in the Bhagavad Gita. So many times two words which sound similar and mean similar are brought together to convey a different meaning. Like Purusham Purusharshabha comes in 2.14 in the Bhagavad Gita, 2.15. So like the Purusha and Purusharshabha. So like that Kama and Kami. Bhutatma Bhutatma. Many times in the Bhagavad Gita, this sort of words are repeated. And that creates a musical effect, a poetic effect, but it also has a semantic effect. Semantic means in terms of conveying meaning. So, na kama kami. Kama means desire. Kami means desirer. So, na kama kami means not a desire, a desirer of desire. So, na kama kami. Normally, we think of desirer of sense objects. We said desirer of, somebody's a desirer of sweets, somebody's a desirer of alcohol, desirer of alcohol, somebody may be a desirer of a new smartphone. So, like that, different people may be desirers of different things. So normally, we think of desirer in terms of objects. But here, Krishna is talking about desirer in terms of desires. So, what does desirer of desires mean? This brings in, to answer this, let's consider another point. Normally speaking, desires are something which flow out from us. Isn't it? We see something, we feel I want it. Krishna has also talked about that mode with dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangasteshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha. This is, we see something, dhyayato, and then sangasteshu, hey, that's nice. And then sangat sanjayate, I want it. So that means from us,